prophets 400 times to the north, to the east, to the west, and to the south. 400 times. Praying to Allah. You know, in that time, she never did get to peace. She never did find happiness. She never found joy. Then she had read in the Quran the prophet Jesus. Now, they do have some real stuff in there. And she wanted to know who this prophet Jesus was. She went to one of those mullahs. I hope I'm pronouncing that the correct word. She said, "Who is this prophet Jesus?" You know, he never did answer her. You know, you're an infidel to them. And they'll kid you quicker than you can bat your eye. Because they hate you because you're not Muslim. But that's all right. Jesus wasn't one either. We will walk in love, Ephesians 2:5. And walk in love as Christ also hath loved us and hath given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet smelling savor. He did it for you. He said, "Now, Lord, Father, look what kind of life he's doing. Look what the way it's living. Isn't that pleasing to you? Isn't that wonderful? He's obeying you or she's obeying you." Now, sometimes God might have allowed you to get sick. And he allowed you to get sick where you could get it, look up. And you know, when you got to looking up, you begin to talk to him. And when you get to so sick, you get to praying real nicely to him. Real lovely. I've heard people say, "Lord, if you'll let me out of this hospital, I'll go to church. I'll live for you. I'll witness for you." And he'll take that heart attack away. And there's diseases that the doctors don't know. And my brother-in-law, I told my wife, I said, "Your brother is a good candidate for hell. The way he's living." But when he got saved, he made a 180-degree turn. And the power of the Holy Spirit just lit him up like a light bulb. Now, their mother was in the hospital. They had put medicine that had never been okayed by the medical board. But they'd inject that medicine in her and then take x-rays. And the infection would just go around that medication and kill it. The doctors got where they wouldn't come to them. But to tell you the story, this woman come down to their room, where the waiting room, she says, "I need somebody to pray for us." And her sister told her, our brother's going to be in a little bit. And when he comes, I'll send him to you." When he got there, he went up there and he had to dress out with complete new clothes on. He went into that room and the little girl had a disease that the doctors didn't know. And they were looking for her. Their diagnosis was that she would not live to the next morning. He interceded in Jesus' name. That woman was a backslidden church member. She made a profession of faith in Jesus Christ. That lost her daddy come in there, and he made a profession of faith in Jesus Christ. And the next morning, the little girl was sitting up on side the bed. And when the doctors walked in, the doctor said, honey, you don't supposed to be sitting on side the bed. You're supposed to be laying down. She said, Doc, I'm hungry. And the doctor ordered her breakfast. And that day, he sent her home. But their mother didn't go back to Fourth and Vine on earth. She went to Hallelujah Square. And a woman told her pastor, she said, I'm not going to pray no more because he didn't answer my prayer. The pastor, being wise, said, yes, sister, he did. He answered your prayer, but not the way you wanted it. She doesn't have that pain anymore. She doesn't have that hurting or sorrow anymore. We will walk in faith in 2 Thessalonians 1:3. We are bound to thank God always for you, brethren, as it is meet, because that your faith groweth exceedingly, and the charity of every one of you all towards one another abundantly. Your faith. Lord, don't ask God to give you the faith. Just exercise what faith you've got. When you exercise the faith that you have got, now I got this glass of cup of water this morning because in Sunday school I couldn't hardly talk. Now, when I empty that cup, I don't need to throw this cup away. I just need to wash it again and fill it up again. And you children of God, you don't need to get saved again. You just need to be washed again and filled up again in Jesus with the Holy Spirit. That you'll be able to walk. And hey, when you get out there tomorrow and meet your best friend, I guarantee you, you won't have to tell that individual you got refilled. Because you'll see the glow on, they'll see the glow that's on you. You'll be able to say, thank you, Lord, for using me today. I'm going to say this in close. Friend of mine in West Virginia, the only way that I knew that man was telling the truth was when he wasn't laughing. That's the only way I knew that he was telling the truth. When he was talking to me, he wouldn't laugh. He'd talk. And one day, while we were living down here, we went back to her parents, to her mothers and brothers and sisters. I said, let's go and see him. He's got something to tell me. I pulled up into his yard. He come walking to me with a big grin on his face. He says, I got something to tell you. I said, you don't have to tell me. I'm going to tell you what happened. God, for Christ's sake, has saved you. I told you when you met Jesus, he'd change you. Before he got saved, you couldn't hog time through him in church. But every time church doors open, He was there, praising the Lord just to be alive, thanking God that he, with his health and everything, with the family. There's a change, child of God. Don't be ashamed. Hey, it doesn't matter with them. They glory in themselves of making you mad. They glory in hurting your feelings. They glory because that's a fine Christian. Because, you know, they shouldn't have said that. A Christian wouldn't say that. A Christian wouldn't do that. But you know, the unsaved world has set a high standard for what a Christian ought to live that they can't even live it if they were saved. But hey, in your weak way, God says, my grace is sufficient. Amen. You do what I tell you to do. Go and drink a cup of coffee if you drink coffee. I can't. And you spend time with them. You don't even have to mention you don't even have to mention church, sister. They'll tell you, I'll see you in church next Sunday. But she never says how many next Sundays. You get up and you drink that cup of coffee and says, it's time for me to go. Don't say nothing about church. Don't say nothing about Jesus. You're baiting them. One day, they'll run to you and tell you, I need you to pray for me. I want you to pray now. Not an hour later, not next day, but right now. Usually when they tell me that, right where we're standing before God and mankind, I say, God, this person wants me to come to the throne of grace and ask you for a specific thing. And I ask you for that specific thing. If it's your will to give it, you give it. To your glory and to your honor and to your praise. Do it to him, for him. You're not pleasing mankind now. You're pleasing the Lord Jesus Christ, your Lord, your Master, your Savior, your brother. In closing, in case someone jumps on you, they used to say, my big brother will take care of you. And your big brother is in heaven. He's your brother. If you don't know that, he'll take care of it. He's just waiting for you to tell him. Seek him. And he says, I'm more than pleased to take care of it. Leave him alone. Don't make him mad. He knows just how to handle them. He knows just when to handle them and what to say to them. And when he gets through with them, they'll be glad to come back and tell you, I got mad at you. Well, I didn't know I made you mad. And child of God, I want to tell you something, and I really will hush. I'm over. You know that person that you got mad at? That person goes to home, they go to bed, and they go to sleep.